Greetings and welcome to another episode of Q Points Podcast. I'm DJ Sir Daniel.
And my name is Jay Ray, y'all, sometimes known by my government as Johnny Ray Cornegay III. And Sir Daniel, we're feeling nostalgic today. This is when we get to talk about what we used to watch when we was young folk.
Absolutely, because we, you know, during one of our conversations, and we go off on plenty of tangents, we started thinking, you know what? TV shows dedicated to variety shows, they're far and few in between today. But then we thought about even deeper. There was a time when if you were a Black artist, a musician, there was not a lot of places for you to go and be showcased.
Yep.
So if you're a Black, specifically around hip hop, when that came around, if you were a Black musician, where else could you go? What could you do to be seen by the national audience? Well, on this episode of Q Points, we're going to discuss that. We're going to talk about Black artists and the national TV experience. And starting off in like from the mid-80s to the early 90s, Black musicians had a clear path. Well, prior to that, there was a clear path for them as far as publicity was concerned. Of course, Black radio has always been in effect as the backbone. And then a lot, of course, publications, Black publications. And then you would get artists featured in other publications, national publications as well. Television was a different thing. Television had a lot of standards set by the FCC. And then, of course, if we're talking about pre-civil rights movement era, throughout the civil rights movement era, post-Jim Crow, if you were Black and seen on television, I'm pretty certain it was a very, very controlled environment. And especially if you were a performer, they weren't good. You had to keep them hips still.
Yes.
There was no gyrating of the hips. Everything probably had to be from the waist up. And you had to be very careful about what you were singing about and how you looked on television programs back then. But but as we evolved as artists, especially coming along with the advent of hip hop, you know, Black people wanted an edgier look, edgier vibes and sounds. But where were you going to go if you wanted to get on television? Because television, Jay Ray, was king.
There's no other way around it. It was so, in order to get on national TV, there were really only a few places that you can go unless you crossed over. And you would have to cross over to a really major degree on the pop charts to really kind of be taken seriously in terms of white specific shows. Now, what's interesting is we're talking about national exposure, right?
Yes.
There were always regional shows, like top of mind, I'm thinking, you know, they're in New York, they had Soul, which was on PBS. It was Ellis Hazlip, which did feature a lot of Black artists in the 1970s, but that was not a national show, right?
No.
It was an amazing and groundbreaking show, but you kind of had to be in the region to know anything about it. But from a national standpoint, especially in the 1980s and 1990s, with the rise of hip hop, there was really just a few places that you can go. And even the Black shows, so we're going to talk about a show in a minute, even the Black shows were resistant to hip hop at the beginning. Like, that's, it was right, not the Black shows, the major nationally syndicated Black show was resistant to hip hop at the beginning, because, you know, they came along in those the late 60s, early 70s, and it was just a different time. So of course we're talking about one of the places that if you were a Black artist and a place that you can go was Soul Train, right?
Yes. Soul Train started out locally, as you were talking about, in Chicago. It was a local show. But then in October 2nd of 1971 went national and became syndicated in every household across the country. Let's just sit with that for a moment. And imagine being a young Black person and turning on the television and seeing everybody looking like you, just bopping and having a good time. When I see those clips online, J-Ray, I have to, real quick, when I see those clips online and say, I just love how everybody was bopping in syncopation, especially when like BT Express came on, do it till you're satisfied. Everybody was like, dun-dun, dun-dun, you know, moving in syndication. And it's those things that just stand out to me up and how beautiful Soul Train looked aesthetically. They had all the Black commercials.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Afro Sheen.
Afro Sheen. Why do we all think of Afro Sheen
first? It's always Afro Sheen, and it makes you look like Cleopatra. You know, all the things that we love, that we needed in, as consumers as well back in the day. But you're right. You know, imagine coming up in the 60s and 70s, you know, Don Cornelius is very suited and strict. And here come these hip hoppers.
These hippity hops with their sneakers and chains.
And God bless them. Don Cornelius interviewing rappers was always the funniest thing. So, Mr. Kool Moe Dee. With the very long microphone, Mr. Kool Moe Dee. What does the Modi mean? You know, I'm being facetious, but it was very, you could tell there was a disconnect between Don Cornelius and the uprising culture of hip hop. Yeah. But we still had a place to go.
Yes.
It was still an important place for someone on the come up to stop at Soul Train, because Soul Train is just a part of Black culture, and you have to go there. You have to be a part of that show. It's a part of your journey as an artist, a Black artist, is to be on Soul Train.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Soul Train. I mean, Soul Train ran for so long. It's crazy to think, y'all, Shamar Moore was a host of Soul Train for like a long time. Shamar Moore. You're trying to forget that.
Especially when he was dancing.
He was dancing. Shamar Moore, who's always on your TV sets weekly, hosted Soul Train for a long time. At the same time that he was on like The Young and the Restless or one of the, or The Bold and the Beautiful, whatever. But it's where we had to go. And such an important and iconic show. So we definitely wanted to lift that up. But now, so to that point, so Soul Train for me, Sir Daniel, I'm curious for you in New York and in the Atlanta area. For me, Soul Train came on Saturdays. So I got to see it after cartoons. So it would typically be like whenever cartoons ended. So either 11 or 12 before the Kung Fu Saturday, we would get an hour of Soul Train. When did Soul Train come on for you?
So, as I've told you all on this podcast before, you know, I grew up Seventh-day Adventist. So
that's right.
So I was always yanked to church on Saturday morning, except for the few times that I got to stay home, where I played sick and got to stay home, and I would have to sneak and turn on the television to see the cartoons, like you were just saying, and to catch Soul Train. But you're absolutely right. I think it was the same. The timing was around the same.
Okay.
The format came, like, you came on around noon after the cartoons. So yeah, because, well, we're in the tri-state area. Yeah. So I don't think it was that different from where you were in Pennsylvania. Yeah, that's around the same time that it came on. But man, stealing those moments to see Soul Train, and by that time to see whoever the guest host would be, because like you said, you had your Shamar Moores, you had your Tashina Arnolds, and whoever was popping at the time would be a guest host on Soul Train. So Soul Train did a great job of passing down the baton when it came to having hosts and people being a part of the show. And Soul Train was a midday type of thing, right?
Yes.
It was a daytime type of show. But nighttime television was also popping.
Nighttime television
was, you know, back in the day, you had your Dick Cavett's. Of course, you had Johnny Carson, who was the GOAT.
Yes.
And what's the other comedian? The Chin.
Who are you? David Letterman?
David Letterman, and the one he was feuding with was going up
against. Oh, who was he going up against? We talk about Jay Conan.
Leno. Jay Leno.
He took over the Tonight Show from Johnny Carson.
Yeah. Exactly. So you know who else who did a guest stint on the Carson show? Arsenio.
Man, you want to talk about iconic. You want to talk about the most important nighttime show? I feel like in TV history, there was nothing like the Arsenio Hall show in the late 80s and the early 90s. And shout out to our folks, They Reminisce Over You. They do a great show about the history of the Arsenio Hall show. Go check that out. But that show, Sir Daniel, late night, that is where you wanted to be. That was the coolest show on TV.
That was the ticket. I mean, Arsenio, and he had the posse.
The posse, with you, David.
And Arsenio became larger than life to us specifically, yeah, because we saw, that's one of the first places that we saw hip hop.
Yes.
Being celebrated, not just, you know, here's this group, they've got a hit on the charts, such and such, you know, a rap group. Arsenio knows of the culture, is of the culture, and would have them on, and would also talk to them, would have the artists speak to them after the show. They would have an interview session, which a lot of artists didn't get. They just came and performed, and then that was it. But on Arsenio, you got to sit on the couch with him. You got to chop it up with him. You felt safe with him there. I keep going back to this moment in A Tribe Called Quest history, where they went on the show and performed, and a audience member, some white dude, got up and was like putting his thumbs down and booing them during their performance because they were sampling that. This was when they were performing Can I Kick It. At the time, they were going through some litigation with Lou Reed, who's the original song was called Walk on the Wild Side, that Can I Kick It samples. And, you know, some guy was in the audience being vocal about and being disrespectful. Arsenio stopped the music, called the man out, and blessed him in front of everybody and was like, how dare you? These are some kids, some talented kids. They've got a hit record, and we're going to respect them.
Yes.
Arsenio had so much respect from all of us at that time. He was respectful of he showed love to the East, and he showed love to the West Coast because the show was filmed right there on the West Coast. So a lot of Cali rappers got a lot of exposure on Arsenio Hall show. Jerry, do you remember when Arsenio dropped his own rap record?
Oh, was that the Chunky A?
Chunky.
Wow, that just flew back.
The parody record. The parody songs. What was the one? Dang, he Chunky But Funky. I think that was the name of the album. That sounds
right.
Yeah, that was Arsenio. Yeah, he played in our face a little bit with that one, but he's still a legend and still created a platform for black musicianship.
Yeah,
in the late 80s throughout the 90s, that show premiered January 3rd, 1989.
Yeah,
and it went on till 1994.
Yeah, abruptly, of course, off the air, but shout out to, that was definitely a place from a national standpoint that you could get some exposure. And this next show that we wanted to talk about does not get brought up enough in these conversations, and it deserves to.
It sure
because
does.
We owe Dee Barnes so much for what she did for the culture. And the fact that she gave us Pump It Up. So I remember being able to check out Pump It Up, which was a national show. So we're talking about shows that were on network TV too. I want to be clear because some people might be like, but there was Yo. Yo was on cable.
Yes.
So back, everybody
cable
didn't
was a luxury.
Have, cable was a luxury. Everybody didn't have cable. So if you needed to, from a national standpoint, to get some exposure, you wanted a show that was on network television. Right. So I got the opportunity to see Pump It Up. It was on Fox at the time when I was young. And I remember being able to stay up late. Now, I did have access to cable, but I stayed up late still on a Saturday night specifically. I think it came on before Saturday Night Live where I was, or it was like right while Saturday Night Live was happening. But anyway, I got a chance to catch Pump It Up on Fox. And I got a chance to see artists because it was taped in LA. It was a very LA centric show. I got to be introduced to artists out there that I had never been introduced to before. I remember Sway and King Tech would play on there. So I got a chance to be introduced to artists like that that I would never know. And King T, Pump It Up was a place where you could go and Dee would talk to you. She was from hip hop. She would talk to you like hip hop and really give you a solid interview, but also show music videos. So that was a dope spot for me to be able to see artists.
Yeah, I specifically appreciate how she did, like, they did this kind of guerrilla form of recording mm-hmm. where they would be out on location.
Yeah.
And would have the artists meet up in various yep. locations. Like, we, ever since Dave from De La Soul passed away, you know, all mm-hmm. the old clips kept resurfacing of them out in California meeting with her and them being out in some field somewhere, yeah. you know, talking about the albums and whatnot. And so it just, it was a really, a truly organic and fun time mm-hmm. and like you said, we need to give Dee Barnes her propers big time for doing that. You you mentioned Pump It Up came on late on Saturday night mm-hmm. so in New York, Pump It Up came on after SNL mm-hmm. and right before Showtime at the Apollo, which is the next syndicated yeah. yep. Platform that we're going to talk about. September 12th, 1987, Showtime at the Apollo goes nationally syndicated, but still late at night. But apparently we were all staying up late so we could yeah. watch Showtime at the Apollo. Yeah. Showtime at the Apollo not only was a place for national recording artists to go on, but Showtime at the Apollo was like the original American Idol.
Yeah. Oh, it really was, because the Apollo Amateur Night was famous yeah. and replicated so much. Even when you watch, even when you see the film Dreamgirls or talk about like Amateur Night, we were really all those years replicating what the Apollo Theater had been doing. So yeah, you're absolutely right. That was the original Black American Idol. You're mm-hmm. right.
And it had numerous guest hosts. We've spoken about Malcolm Jamal Warner being a guest host. Of course, famously, Steve Harvey mm-hmm. with his hot top fade hairpiece
yep. that we all found out later. our brother Sinbad.
Sinbad, yes. We cannot glaze over Sinbad. And you know what? You know who became iconic from this show? Well, two people. Sandman.
Yes.
Sandman was a whole icon. And of course, the lovely Kiki Shepherd, who would slink onto the stage, who would rub the tree stump, and she was famous for putting her hand over the heads of the contestants on yes. Amateur Night. And she was just it. You know, the beautiful smile, a dark-skinned woman at that.
Absolutely.
Being an icon of late night television. And like we said, so many stars came through that show. Hip hop, R&B, jazz. There's a story attached to Showtime at the Apollo, which is a bittersweet story, because I remember seeing the trajectory of this person on Amateur Night.
Yeah.
Go from a shy contestant to a continuous winner.
Yeah.
A lot of you may not know the name, but you should know the name, David Peaston. Mm-hmm. David Peaston was if I'm not mistaken, he was from Ohio.
Somewhere in the Midwest. I feel like it was like St. Louis, but somewhere in the Midwest.
St. Louis he was a school teacher mm-hmm. and he came out and he liked to sing. Now, David Peaston was a big guy.
Yep.
Unassuming. You could tell he was nervous, but he was shy. But when he opened up his mouth, he sang that house down to the point where he came back week after week yep. and he was packing everybody up. Mm-hmm. Each week, he packed everybody up and he went on to win several times as an amateur contestant on Showtime at the Apollo. so much to the point where he got a record deal.
Yeah. Yeah.
He got a record deal and became an actual recording artist. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, we still don't, there's a gap in that history. A lot of people don't remember that piece of the David Peaston story.
Yeah. David Peaston is one of those artists that also deserves to be remembered. To your point, Sir Daniel, about his trajectory on his Showtime at the Apollo. In addition to the fact that, you know, he was really trying to make it as a recording artist in the 1990s as a big Black man in an industry that wasn't particularly fond. You had to be a certain type of Black man. If you weren't Gerald Levert, like that type of Black man, that type of big Black man, it was going to be different for you. And David Peaston wasn't that, right? But he got the opportunity to make two records and unfortunately died, got sick really early and then died really early. But is one of those artists that came directly from that stage into our homes as a recording artist. And that is the power of what It's Showtime at the Apollo was able to do, and that Apollo Amateur Night stage.
Absolutely. And that's why we have to lift up these platforms, and you have to remember them. You have to remember Soul Train. You got to give it up for Arsenio Hall. You have to pay respect to Dee Barnes and Pump It Up. And we have to show love to Showtime at the Apollo, because without a lot of these shows, some of your favorite artists, iconic artists, legendary status artists would not have been seen on a nationally syndicated show. We do, before we wrap up, we do have to point out this one sparkling moment in rap music history.
Yeah.
February 14th, 1981, Debbie Harry introduces the musical guest of the night on Saturday Night Live, and it is the Funky Four plus One More. First rap group ever to be featured on a national television platform. J-Ray, talk about it.
Man, so I didn't see this until much later. You know, I didn't see it because as a kid, I was probably like four. But as I started getting into VH1 actually showed me this history, because remember VH1 would kind of do a year in, or they would do like these these wrap-ups of what would happen. And I remember seeing it on maybe an I Love the 80s or something like that. And I was floored to know that this happened. And eventually Saturday Night Live released like a DVD or some type of series where you could see like old clips and things from the thing. So I was able to rent it and see it. Man, these were kids.
Yep.
In this new form of music, birthed in New York. Debbie Harry was already a huge fan, right? So she was already white girl rapping in like Rapture, right? Fat Five Freddy, you know what I'm saying? So she was already hip. And I'm sure she championed like, no, they need to be on the show.
Yes.
But the fact that you get to see these young men and this young girl
who completely steals the show,
rapping on stage, it reminded you how important representation was.
Absolutely. And so that's what we do here on Cue Points Podcast. Thank you so much for going down this road of Black music history. J-Ray, remind the people how they can get more of Cue Points Podcast in their life.
Y'all, this is dope. Thank y'all for hanging out with us. So first and foremost, if you can see our faces, if you can hear our voices, hit the subscribe button wherever you are. And if they have a notification bell, hit that too. Do us a solid and share the show with your friends, family, colleagues. If you enjoy Cue Points, chances are they will also enjoy Cue Points. Please go ahead and support the show. You can use Cash App, you can buy us a coffee, or you can shop our store at store.qpoints.com. We'd really appreciate it. Get dope gear like our Slow Jams Can Heal Us shirt and much, much more. And visit our website at qpoints.com where you can sign up for our newsletter and read our blog. We really appreciate y'all and we love y'all.
That's right. Like I always say, in this life, you have a choice. You can either pick up the needle or you can let the record play. I'm DJ Sir Daniel.
My name is Jay Ray, y'all.
And this has been Q Points Podcast, dropping the needle on Black music history. We will see you on the next go round. Peace, y'all.
Peace.